She sat in my chair. There.
Mea culpa. Jennifer Dean is the invasive species biologist for the New York Natural Heritage Program. She helps manage IMAP Invasives, the state invasive species database, by providing biological expertise and education and outreach to encourage reporting. So please report. Jennifer has a doctorate in entomology from Penn State University with a focus on plant-insect interactions in the ag systems, and a bachelor's degree in botany, and has worked in conservation-related projects across the country. And before I pass it on to you, I just want to put a plug for tomorrow at Five Rivers Environmental Education Center. There's going to be an IMAP invasives training, which is right now underpopulated. So please consider coming back to Five Rivers in Del Mar tomorrow. And if you want any more information about that, you can go to the IMAP invasives exhibit upstairs.
And actually, perfect plug, because it's at, on the last slide, I have the web link for that training.
Okay, so I just need you to put that on so we can hear you on the video.
Thank you.
Take it away, Jennifer.
Thank you. All right, thank you, everyone. And so a common theme that we keep hearing about with each of these talks is, okay, we have so many issues at hand, whether it's in agricultural systems or natural resource systems. How do we even begin trying to figure out where we put our limited time and funding and people time on the ground to look for things and to control things? And this is this ongoing problem. And you know, to give away the ending, I don't have one definitive answer, but just more information to start thinking about, and you know, thinking about how the state is approaching these kind of questions, and all these state partners that are working together with the PRISMs and the PRISM partners all together. And so one of these partners has been working on invasive species issues is the Natural Heritage Program, and so that's my home. We're working on providing information about biodiversity to the state for rare and endangered species and natural communities, significant natural systems. And part of that is thinking about the threats to these natural resources of New York State. And so the state had asked us many years ago to start also managing the invasive species locations and information for the state, in addition to the rare species information, because it's that coupling of these different data sets that can really provide a lot of information and strategic thinking components into how do we even go about starting to protect our natural resources because of this. And so, Carrie, you would think that Carrie and I collaborated beforehand to get the same invasive species curve slide, but this is, it was just total coincidence, but it's a really good one. So this invasive species curve that you'll see a lot when people are talking about invasive species is just so important to keep thinking about, where, you know, on the x-axis, you have the time since introduction of a new species, of an invasive species. So invasive meaning that it's going to cause some type of harm and grow and reproduce very quickly. So as that population exponentially increases, your area that's actually infested, of course, increases, but that is also correlated with your control cost. And of course, we want to ideally be working on the bottom of that invasive species curve at the prevention stage. And we've heard about some of the great efforts in prevention. But realistically, things become introduced and we have to deal with them, and we want to catch those introduced things, you know, before their populations get out of hand. So working in that eradication zone where eradication is still feasible. But in many cases, unfortunately, a lot of times those populations do get out of hand before we catch it or before we realize how big of a problem it is. And that's when you're getting into that far area of the curve where, you know, any of your control projects are really just local and site-based. You know, you might be controlling, say, barberry on your preserve to help, you know, control some of the native rodent populations to then control some of the tick populations, but you're not going to eliminate barberry from the state. So, you know, you have to start, your mindset has to change once you get to different areas along this curve. And so we want to, you know, we're constantly thinking about how we prioritize our invasive species efforts in these different lenses that are very commingled. And we've heard a lot about each of these in the previous talk. So thinking about what species we're focusing on, where we're focusing those efforts, and what pathways we're also focusing on, like how are these species species getting to certain locations. So there's a lot of overlap in all of these. And in many cases, you know, these intersections become our projects. So you might be controlling something specifically on a preserve, a particular species, or you might be working on a particular pathway for a species, like trying to control some aquatic species by doing the boat launch or the boat inspections and so forth. And so starting with the pathways, this is covered very well by Carrie's talk earlier this morning. There are so many pathways bringing new species into the country. And so thinking about like how things get here originally, and I just have a couple of examples, and I think, you know, we've talked about this a little bit already, but some of those classic examples are ballast water. So these big ships coming in from other continents, they take up the ballast water to stabilize the ship as it crosses the ocean, and then dump that ballast water when they get closer to port, and all those aquatic organisms can then, you know, find this new home. Wooden pallets, you know, those forest pests that Jerry just mentioned, many of those have been brought in from wood from other countries. The horticultural and pet trade, there are many species that, you know, we want those nice charismatic pythons or, you know, some type of organism that you want to keep as a pet, or your new landscaping plants. You can, you know, those can be our next new invader possibly. And luckily there are quite a few international, or I guess national laws and regulations, you know, trying to keep down what could be brought in by ballast water, wooden pallets. You know, of course, there's lots of work to be done on that as well. But then once something does get to North America, how can we prevent it from spreading? Or even, you know, once it gets into New York, how do you start, you know, slowing that spread, like what Jerry was mentioning with the EAB? And so our main spread vectors, of course, are humans. You know, we might be picking up those new pets or those new landscape plants and bringing them in and further dispersing them. Of course, contaminated soil or contaminated firewood or other types of wood can move pests quite readily. There's natural dispersal. So once something is here, then birds might pick it up, or the seeds and propagules are dropping into the water. So those get naturally spread. And hitchhikers, not the ones on the side of the road with their thumb out, but the ones that, say, like the Asian gypsy moth might be, if it did come into our ports, it could easily lay its egg mass, say, on your RV camper, and just like the European gypsy moth does, and you can transport it further in state. So all these things are pathways that we have to think about. Luckily, in New York State, as has been mentioned a couple times by Chris and Carrie, that we have these regulations like the Part 575 that helps cut down on this, you know, further movement of these known invasive species. We have like the clean your boat regulations, which are great for helping to prevent the spread of those, and the firewood regulations, of course. And then what species should we be targeting? So thinking about you know, this whole slew of both agricultural pests and natural resource pests, and there's a lot of overlap in those lists, how do we even go about figuring out what to focus on first? And really it comes down to what has the highest impacts and the most successful control possible. So which ones do we actually have a chance of controlling? We do have a lot of high impact species that are already here, and they are very widespread, and so we're not necessarily going to have we're not going to be able to eliminate it from the state. So it's, you know, it's on that far right hand side of that invasion curve, but we also have high impact species that are just starting to become established. And so for each of these species, you know, you need to think about those impacts on many different things. So conservation value is one that we're thinking a lot about, like at the Heritage Program and many of the state agencies and prison partners, but also like ecosystem services, thinking about your watershed, your water supply. I know there's a lot of work that the New York State DEP or New York DEP does, the Department of Environmental Protection, for the New York City water supply. Human health, of course, is a big thing, and the economy. There's so many agricultural resources within New York State that invasive species obviously are impacting, as we just heard. And then also considering that the feasibility of control. So whether something is far and widespread is going to be a different type of strategy than something that is at a very low abundance, and whether or not those control methods are actually available. So we're lucky in New York State, as our speakers have mentioned, that we do have these resources to help people, find these, find information and start making these kind of priority decisions. We have had, I think, about 200 or 300 species now of plants and animals ranked for invasiveness. And this is a scientific protocol that has been developed. It started on Long Island with the Nature Conservancy and the Brooklyn Botanic Garden, where they developed these protocols to look at the impacts of invasive species and actually rank them, whether they're a very high invasiveness versus a low invasiveness. So those are available right now on the NIAS.info website. So each of those rankings, you can download those, and they're very intensive rankings for each individual species. So it's a great resource to have. And many of the PRISMs actually have taken that protocol and done these rankings for the PRISM specific region as well. And we have this whole wonderful network of experts in New York State. The PRISMs are a go-to source. They have these full-time coordinators and staff that can help direct you towards resources for invasive species questions. And many of them are out there on the ground actually doing management and surveys. And the New York State agencies, we have Department of Ag and Department of Environmental Conservation that are really working hard on invasive species issues and coming up with some of the best practices to control these. And cooperative extension, of course, I know there's a lot of cooperative extension agents that have learned about invasive species, so then they can further educate all the people in their region. And we do have the invasive species database, the IMF Invasives database, as a resource for all of you to find more information about invasive species. We have reporting tools. You can use your smartphone out in the field to record invasive species and populate the map with site-specific observations. This collective reporting from hundreds of organizations and individuals and agencies leads to better species distribution maps for the state. And so we have a better handle of where things are and where they aren't. And with this collective information of like 180,000 observations for about 300 or 400 species of plants and animals, you can then start generating reports of species lists, say for your town or your county or your watershed, approaching region reports, which means show me everything that's not in my county but in surrounding counties. So what's knocking at the door? So there's a lot of these built-in reports and queries that you can do to really start getting the information that you need to make specific decisions about your area. And there are ways to set up your early detection alerts as well. So getting to know which things are coming in. And as high priority species get entered into the database, then those alerts get funneled out to many of you here, the state experts, whether it's an expert for particular species like lands and forest, and Department of Agriculture and Markets get reports on any insects or forest pests that come in automatically. The PRISM leaders get reports for what's been entered into their PRISM as well. So just helping keeping that chain of communication going. We've been trying to pull this information together to come up with ways to list out species based on how easy they are to get rid of, essentially, or how easy they are to control, based on the impacts that they have and their abundance, which for some species abundance will be correlated with eradication success, but sometimes it's not. Like once like spiny water flea gets into a water body, you can't necessarily get rid of that, even if it's just one water body. So you don't have to go into the details of this, but we have some copies up at the IMF Invasives table, basically putting species into boxes of, if it's a high or very high impact, like on the y-axis, versus the abundance slash the feasibility of control for that species. And so we're trying to work with the PRISMs to create these lists for each PRISM just for some general reference, so if somebody finds something, they can refer to these lists and know that for, say, the Long Island PRISM, you know, what, even though it might be a different suite of species that fall into the eradication as possible category, then, say, for Western New York, it's still, that definition is still applies. Like, eradication means that, you know, it has a very low abundance and a high probability of success if you could control it, and so you need to really focus your survey efforts on those species. And we're with this species ranking system, or this tier system, the CAPMO PRISM, so you're all currently housed, or well, currently sitting in the Capitol Mohawk PRISM. That list has been already created, and I know a number of other PRISMs are working on it, like the Lower Hudson PRISM, and actually they created their list as well, and APIP and CRISP are also working on their list. So we're getting to a point where many different PRISMs are working on these, and it should be a really interesting outcome to see how the different lists will compare in each of those tiers. And then also thinking about where are we going to focus our efforts as we're dealing with invasive species. And of course, there's many different values that your particular organization might hold for, you know, what you're trying to protect from invasive species. And, you know, you could think about, say, protected areas, high conservation value areas. There are just lots of different values. Agricultural resources, of course, are key. Recreation destinations, like if your fishing pond gets choked up with water milfoil or Eurasian water milfoil, then your recreational value has drastically dropped. Thinking about high risk areas, so I have a photo of a pile of pallets over there, the wooden pallets, you know, that might just be an eyesore to most people, but I know to a lot of the forest pest experts here, that could be a high risk area. There could be a new forest pest emerging from those if they weren't properly treated at their source. And of course, areas that are not heavily invaded. You know, you think of like the Adirondacks, where you have a lot of unfragmented forest areas, and it's a very different feel when you're driving up I-87. You know, you get out of the Lower Hudson Valley and out of the Capitol Mohawk District, where you see like Phragmites lining the highways and stuff. And then when you get up to the Adirondacks, you can tell that this is not a heavily invaded spot, and that's something we want to keep that way. So with help from a lot of different partners across the state, the Heritage Program had been working on these spatial prioritization maps for dealing with invasive species. And the goal for these maps are to help natural resource managers prioritize where to focus their efforts for survey and control work by coupling that conservation value with risk of spread. Oops. Sorry about that. And so just in a nutshell, the very basic framework that we started with was by compiling spatial data that already exists for New York State that has, you know, that in some way influences invasive species control decisions. And so we used spatial layers that included statewide coverage and had a pretty fine scale resolution, so we could get down to that local site level modeling. And then we created new synthesis layers for each of these. So these synthesis layers are driven by our stakeholder feedback and expected uses of these maps. And these are focused on conservation value to begin with. But as we go through this process, we're envisioning lots of other ways to that you could customize these maps by incorporating different values into it. So you could do something, say, with a more agricultural focus or recreational focus than a conservation value focus. But this is what our first attempt at this map is, focusing on conservation value and also incorporating protection status of lands and also that risk of spread. And so I'll just walk you through each of those three components and what some of the information that's incorporated in them. So for the ecological significance, which is the heaviest driver within this map analysis layer that we created, it includes the rare species information that the Heritage Program has been accumulating for many years, and also distribution models predicting where rare species might be, where their habitats may be. We also use the stream biomonitoring data from the New York State DEC as a proxy for watershed health, and predicted native mussel richness as well, which also helps identify significant areas for watershed health. We also made a component layer for protected or natural lands, and we used the New York Protected Areas database, and this was created by the New York Natural Heritage Program as a way to aggregate any types of lands that have some type of conservation value. So whether that's your town park, or it could be a state park, and so using that conservation protection status, we also included the National Land Cover Database, natural cover criteria as well from the USGS maps. And then risk of spread is basically human impacts. And so we created a component heat map showing, say, the transportation networks, the urban and suburban areas, utility corridors, as well as the land use, land cover. And we also tied into this recreational use of natural areas, so where humans are really intersecting the natural lands. So incorporating the DEC information for boat launches, campgrounds, and trailheads. And when we put these all together, we adjusted weights, and you don't have to read the details of this, but this is also available. I'm trying to think if I brought copies today. I might not have brought copies today, but I can certainly give you a copy. But just to point out, each of those different components that I showed you have different weights associated with them that were determined by our stakeholder groups. And essentially what it came down to was, for this final model product that we created, this heat map, over half of it was driven by the conservation value or the ecological significance of that land. 13% was driven by the protected or natural land components. And then about a third of the model weight was determined by the risk of spread or that human impact. And so what we come up with is this yellow and red heat map here showing areas of high conservation value with high risk of new invasion and dispersal. So coupling those two main factors. And we want people in different agencies and organizations to use these at different scales. And so thinking about that state scale, state agencies could certainly be using these. Say DOT is looking to prioritize where along major roads they can control for invasive species and get their best conservation value or return on investment for their work. But really we think, another key component is using it as a regional scale. And so I put the prism lines on there and zooming into the Capital Mohawk prism. So, thinking that the prism leaders might be able to use this to focus their invasive species efforts on areas of high value that are prone to new invasion and dispersal. And zooming in even further to that more site or local level, thinking of examples, say state parks could use this, and I've zoomed into Thatcher State Park here in the Albany area, and thinking, maybe you have a big crew of volunteers coming out tomorrow and you need to send them somewhere that's easily accessible but will have a good conservation impact. And so you can look for overlay the invasive species data and look for areas that would give them a good return on investment for their manpower. And then, of course, we can add more power to the models by adding in the invasive species information that we have. And so we've accumulated a lot of this information from many of you here in the audience that have been reporting to IMAP invasives, so that we can overlay the data with these components of the map or the synthesis maps that we created. So here's an example with just the conservation value layer. So, you know, where could you focus surveys to protect your park in the areas of highest conservation value? You could, you know, just turn on that layer on the map so that you can focus on ecological significance. And you could do the reverse. You could focus in on the risk of spread and, you know, thinking about species that move along human corridors, how could you focus your survey, say, for early detections of those species in your preserve? And of course, we want people to use these maps, so we have them available in IMAP Invasives. You can also request the actual GIS files if you want to do some work yourself in ArcGIS by emailing our office, and then we'll send you a Dropbox link to the, for the TIFF files. And just a quick preview or view of what it looks like within IMAP Invasive. So you can turn on these analysis layers. You can go from the, say, the total synthesis map to the risk of spread or the ecological significance. And of course, you can turn on the invasive species information and zoom in and out to these different areas. And so trying to tie all that together, you know, you have different projects. Once you've identified what species and what locations, what pathways you want to focus on. And this is really, you know, can be a difficult part too, because you could have tons of potential projects even within your one preserve or your one region. How do you start prioritizing those? And this is just one example of this is a project feasibility tool specifically for terrestrial plants that the Nature Conservancy created. And it's just even walking through the process of it's really great because it helps, you know, formalize some of that general knowledge that we have about trying to prioritize these things, but it puts it into a format where you're really forced to sit down and evaluate, okay, is this really going to be feasible? And they created it to make sure that they weren't going down that slippery slope of just like treating and then it comes back and then you treat again and it comes back, and so you're on this continuous process of management. And so essentially what it comes down to is evaluating whether your species at hand is actually creating some type of impact, and then based on the abundance and the feasibility of control for that species, is this something that's either going to be, you know, one-time deal, you can be in and out and get rid of this like new early detections plant, or is this going to be a long-term maintenance project, which in many cases it is, but you just need to know that going into it. And of course, we want to track our project success. I mean, sometimes this might be project failures, but we need to know that too. That's, you know, very valuable information. And so we've built in ways to track your treatments and, you know, the follow-up surveys and assessments to determine whether or not your project is successful. And by having this collective spot to put all that information, then land managers and water managers can be seeing what other people have done and whether or not that worked, say, for treatment of Phragmites in a certain area. So just, you know, making sure that everyone out there can share that information. I know that that's one of the biggest questions I get when I go to a training session or I do a talk. You know, people ask, okay, so what are some examples of success across the state? Where have we actually won the battles or, you know, made some progress? And so, you know, by recording that information, making sure it gets out there, then we can help talk about those successes. All right, and so I know we're waiting to the end for questions, but I can, in that yellow box, put a plug for what Joellen mentioned at the beginning. We do have invasive species workshop tomorrow at Five Rivers, and so you can learn how to report things with IMAP Invasives, and we'll have some species ID experts for terrestrial and aquatic species.
And I've already been asked what time that starts.
Oh, that's a great question. Okay. Meg, what time does the training start tomorrow?
9 o'clock is a tour of the building, the new DEC energy savvy building.
Great. Thank you.
All right. Thank you.